In this video, we will focus a little more on how we go about setting up the optimization problem for parameter estimation. It is on the flavor of least squares, but there are many interesting modifications that one can perform. So, what is it that people normally do? You have some time course. Let us just plot an arbitrary time course. You would not have the time course, in fact, you would only have data points. Deliberately drawing the errors as somewhat asymmetric. Maybe let us just assume this is a simple Michaelis-Menten. Let us start even with a simple Michaelis-Menten. Even before we get here, you may have to answer some questions about the data. First, quality, then quantity, reliability, reproducibility, so many more things. Assuming your data are good, you can then start with the fitting process. But if you look at the classic fitting process, can you tell me which of these is the best curve? Let's label them. One, two, three, four. I think most of you would say three. In fact, that's what most of your algorithms would estimate. Let's give this something. Why? Because you have this strange fascination to the mean. Right. What is so special about the mean? It's not even a data point you observe. You never observed the mean, by the way. You observed x1, x2 and x3. You did x1 plus x2 plus x3 by 3 and you computed the mean. So, the mean wasn't even observed by you in the experiment as such. So, how would you, let's start with the classic least square fit. You would basically say x model measured minus x predicted whole square, right? This would be your standard cost function, right? So in fact, let's make. In fact, you would say is that right? Across every data point, you minimize the sum squared error. Is that fine? Is that a good idea? There is one issue here. Let us say your points are your xm and x predicted are 0.1, 0.15, 2.1, 2.15, 101.1, 101.15. What is the sum squared error that you will get? Is that right? Error in each case is just 0.05. But does it seem fine to penalize? This is, well, perfect, it seems. Whereas this is an error of much higher error. It is an error of literally 50%, right? Do you agree? Whereas, what is the percentage error here? Clearly less than 1%, right? But here it is 50%, and your all these have equal contribution towards your cost function. Does that make sense?
The data set is over a wide range of parameters.
It could be a problem. So, if your data scales weirdly, you may have to normalize it. Right? So one easy way to do that is, so this looks better, right? This is already a little better. The one other issue that still remains is, you are asking your model to be better than your data. Aren't you doing that? Because you want every point, the curve to pass through the mean of every point, whereas that's not even what you observed in reality. So anything that falls between your bars is actually a good curve, that falls between your error bars like this. So all, I would say that these four curves are modulo the, you know, inaccuracies in drawing are essentially equal. I wouldn't say one is better than the other. And let's zoom in. Let's zoom in to a particular point here. No, you have multiple. So in a good biological sample, you need to have technical replicates and biological replicates, right? What is a biological replicate? What is a technical replicate? Technical replicate is just repeating your measurement thrice, sort of. Biological experiment replicate is running it in two different reactors, two different cells. If you are doing a chemical experiment, it is not a big deal. You know, you assume that the compounds are going to behave the same more or less, right? But two cells aren't the same. Two cells will differ. So if you have two different cells, two different populations of cells, you want to study them separately, right? So this, let's assume this is averaged across everything. This is let's say biological duplicates across technical triplicates, right? So I'm talking about an ideal scenario, never the case, right? And one more issue that you would have is, it is somewhat related to this issue. In many biological systems, the initial response is very rapid. So it is not unusual to find a curve that looks like this. So you are not only worried about this error, you are actually worried about how good your is your stopwatch. Where did you exactly stop the time and when did you exactly make the sampling? If you have an auto sampler, all that, great, but potentially a small variation. So let's say you measure t as 0.5 seconds and you got some x, but maybe your error in measurement was 0.2 seconds. The delta in y might be much higher. You have to worry about these things. These are all the things that will practically go wrong when you build these models. Which is why I have literally not focused on the theory of dynamic modeling, which is basically writing ODEs. We can easily do that. We saw a couple of examples yesterday, no big deal. But then in practice, how do you handle these models? How do you know if your model is good at all? So we are getting to what is a measure of goodness, right? So this is a measure of goodness. So if we zoomed into this point, you have something like this and you have a few curves that go, one curve that goes here, one curve that goes here, one curve that goes here, one curve that goes here. You will have to evaluate all these curves carefully, right? So if you looked at another point, let's say that point looks like this and your curves are like this. These two seem equivalent, right? Reasonably similar. Do you agree? The distance of the curve from the mean is not too bad. But the problem is, this was a very tightly distributed point. This was already a poorly measured point. And you may want to give some more leeway to the model here than here. You may want to penalize this curve a lot more than you penalize this curve. So you need a weighted least squares. So let's say we put a
delta, right. Does that add up? So what did we say? You want to do a classic least squares, you want to just take the difference between your point, your measured value and your predicted value, but maybe that is not good enough because as we looked at this example, the same error could, the same you know numerical difference could mean a very different percentage error, right. So in which case you may want to normalize it, that was the first improvement that we did, but then that may not be sufficient because you may have rapid variation in some point and you may have very poor measurements in one point and very good measurements in another point. You want to therefore weight different points differently. So this is what is called heteroscedasticity. You do not have the same standard deviation at every point, right. Each measurement has its own characteristics. So this point's errors are different from this point's errors.
How do you know standard deviation experiment?
You make these replicates, no?
Biological.
So you have a few, I am hoping you have a few measurements, otherwise you have no clue. Otherwise you have to then just have a an approximate feeling of what is a reasonable error that you are willing to admit. I am okay with an error of 10%, I am okay with an error of 15%, right. So that has to factor up in this delta.
Or we can say at initial time I want less error, I want to give more.
Exactly. Okay. Yeah. You do not really care about if you are off in the steady state prediction by 5%, it is not a big deal, right. So this is where it comes back to what we are talking about here, right. Is your delay more important than your peak or is your steady state more important than your delay or peak or whatever. So but potentially you can capture all of these in some sort of a weighted fashion. Some weighted least squares formulation should be able to capture all of these. So if you want, let us add another alpha I here as well. So what is it that we are doing? Maybe I should rewrite it more clearly. So we said your cost function is x measured of I, in fact theta does not apply here, minus x predicted of I for a given parameter set theta divided by x predicted, x measured of I, something to account for the heteroscedasticity of each point and maybe something else to account for the relative importance of each point. How desperate are you to achieve a fit at point I compared to point j?
Bottom delta I
could be some measure of standard deviation. How much error are you willing to accommodate in one point?
We can combine alpha I and delta I.
Potentially, but see alpha I you can just leave it out, right. I am just proposing it as an additional improvement across I experimental points. This is essentially your cost function. This is clearly a nonlinear cost function. Anytime you see the word nonlinear, you have to be worried, right, because everything gets a little tougher for nonlinear systems. Not necessarily, because the problem is how do we compute each of these points? Your problem actually comes here, right. Xp of theta is even more complex. You are going to vary, see it is, you can say it is convex in x or something like that, but you need to look at what is it in theta. It is very very nonlinear in theta.
So that may lead to non-convex.
So it is non-convex. I think there are cases where it may be convex, but I think very rare.
So what's alpha?
Alpha is just some, you okay, you just say that this point has an importance of 0.9, this point has an importance of 0.6, something. So you say something to basically say that I want a much better fit here than I'm going to accommodate poorer fits more here than here.
Do you relative importance of the
points. Relative importance of the points. But you know, this is not commonly used. I'm sort of making it up, but basically it gives you a handle to have much better cost functions. See, the problem is I don't think anybody tunes cost functions. And cost functions need to be tuned, because modeling is a very subjective exercise. It depends upon what is it that you want to achieve at the end of the modeling exercise, and you just can't open fmin search in MATLAB, take the regular cost function and run with it. You are not going to get a good model by doing that. And this is something I really want to emphasize through this course. We want to be very practical, right? We want to solve the real problems that one encounters when doing systems biology. So what do we need to optimize? This is what we need to optimize, right? This is very similar to what I showed you, using C instead of P, computed instead of predicted, but it's the same thing. X measured minus x of theta, I'm using k here, everything else is the same, right? So this is what we need to optimize. So it's essentially a complex nonlinear optimization problem. In this video, we had a good overview of how we set up the optimization problem for parameter estimation. In the next video, we'll look at a classic flowchart for data-driven mechanistic modeling, which is what we've been discussing for the last few classes. So you have some data on a biological system and you want to build a mechanistic model. How do you go about doing it? What are all the various steps involved?